Hello everyone, this is Pulkit Agarwal, the History Faculty at the Saviour Academy. Today we are going to discuss the Prelims 2019 paper of the UPSC Prelims. And more so, we will be focusing only on the history questions that came in the exam. And there were total of 18 questions in the exam, which constituted your 36 marks. And that is a very, very sizable portion in the exam, which can like actually make or break your whole cutoff thing. So the point is, we will be discussing about the source from which exactly these things came in the examinations. I will be also telling you each and every explanation for what exactly the answer required. And I will be also telling you the methods of how to solve the questions, even if you do not know all the answers, or even if you do not know all the options which have been given in a particular question, right? So this is the main agenda of the exam discussion today, which we are going to have now. I hope this is going to enrich and actually motivate you better for the next year's examination, and also for those of you who are less next year's examination. So the first question in front of us is, building Kalyana Mandapa was a notable feature in the temple construction in the kingdom of A. Chalukyas, B. Chandelas, C. Rashtrakutas, and D. Vijayanagar kingdom. So the correct answer is D. So the correct answer is D, that is the Vijayanagar kingdom. Correct answer is D, Vijayanagar kingdom. And the explanation for this is, what is exactly Mandap and what is Kalyan? This is what we need to understand in order to solve the question. Kalyan basically means the, Kalyan means the wedding. Kalyanam. Kalyanam means the wedding, and Mandapa was exactly the place which connected the main shrine with the rest of the shrine. It was a kind of a vestibule. It was kind of a connecting element. And Mandapa was a kind of a pillared hall. Right? So Kalyana means wedding and Mandapa means hall. So when we connect these two terms, Kalyana and Mandapa, it means Kalyana, Mandapa were meant to celebrate divine weddings. And this was a part of your Vijayanagar temple architecture, and Vijayanagar temple architecture was a sub part of the Dravidian style of temple construction, which started during the time of Cholas, right? It started developing from the time of Cholas. So Kalyana Mandapa were nothing but just the marriage halls where the marriages of the divine gods were actually performed, right? So that was a feature which was prevalent in the Vijayanagar kingdom, right? So the answer is D. Okay, we now move on to the second question. Consider the following statements. In the revenue administration of Delhi Sultanate, in charge of revenue collection was known as Amil. In charge of revenue collection was known as Amil. Second point is, the Ikta system of the Delhi Sultanate was an ancient indigenous institution. Third option is, the office of Mir Bakshi came into existence during the reign of Khalji Sultans in Delhi. Which of the following statements is slash are correct? Okay. Options are 1 only, 1 and 2 only, 3 only, last is 1, 2 and 3. So the answer for this particular question is 1 only, that is your answer number A. The explanation is, Amils who were given the responsibility by the king for the collection of the revenue, especially during the time of the Sultanate period in North India, right? And Mir Bakshi, as the third statement says, was a person who was responsible for military pay and accounts. He was person responsible for the military pay and accounts during the time of Mughal Empire, right? So it was a position which was not exactly seen during the time of Delhi Sultanate, but it only came into existence during the time of Mughal Empire, right? But also at the same time, we need to understand that Mir Bakshi, right? So this whole idea, Mir Bakshi as a post was also present in Delhi Sultanate, but through a different name. And a different name was Az-e-Mamalik, right? But The whole point of the question is, when exactly did the office of Mir Bakshi came into existence? So the answer for this particular question would be that it came into existence during the time of Mughal Empire. It came during the time of Mughal Empire, and especially during the time of Akbar, because Akbar was the most important king of the Mughals, right? So this is the basic idea, right? So this is how exactly we are going to solve this particular question. So these questions, the question on the Kalyana Mandapa is directly from your book of Nitin Singhania, which is Art and Culture, and this question, that is the Revenue Administration Delhi Sultanate, this question is directly from Satish Chandra's class 11th book, right? Medieval India NCERT by Satish Chandra. So these questions are very, very easy and are something which are based upon your reading of NCERT only. So that is why I always stress upon the fact that you need to go through the NCERTs very, very thoroughly. And for ancient and medieval, you don't need any other books for the UPSC portion, except for some readings there and some readings there. Okay. So next question is, consider the following statements. Saint Nimbarka was a contemporary of Akbar. Second statement is, Saint Kabir was greatly influenced by Sheikh Ahmed Shirindi. Which of the following statements is slash are correct? One only, two only, both one and two, D, neither one and two. So the answer for this particular question is D, that is neither one or two, right? How? Because Nimbarka is not exactly known, like basically his era is not exactly known, but sometimes he is kind of designated to 12th to 13th century, right? 12th to 13th century does not figure in the even history of Mughal India, because the Mughals started to establish their rule in India from the 16th century onwards, that is from 1526, the rule of Babur. And Akbar, on the other hand, was ruling from 1556 until 1605. So we can easily say that Saint Nimbarka was not a contemporary of Akbar. See, this is again a question which we have already discussed in the medieval history module, in which I was telling you people that you need to understand that who were the important saints, who were important people, who were contemporary of a particular important ruler during the medieval times, like Mughals, Akbar, Jahangir, Shahjahan, all these things. So this is a straight question from the classroom teaching of the Saviour Academy. And now considering the second statement, that Saint Kabir was greatly influenced by Sheikh Ahmed Shirindi. So Kabir belonged to an earlier era than Shirindi, and also Shirindi was Islamic Hanafi scholar of the Naqshbandi Silsila, while Kabir was the follower of Nirgun Bhakti. So if somebody is just a Nirgun saint, so how exactly can we say that Kabir was influenced by Shirindi? Shirindi also was like a scholar of Naqshbandi Silsila, that is, he was influenced by the Sufism. But the point is that Kabir lived before Sheikh Ahmed Shirindi. That is why the point is Saint Kabir was not influenced by Sheikh Ahmed Shirindi, right? So the answer to this question is option number D, that is neither one nor two, right? Next question is, with reference to the British colonial rule in India, consider the following statements. First statement is, Gandhi was instrumental in abolition of the system of indentured labor. Okay. Second is, in Lord Chelmsford War Conference, Mahatma Gandhi did not support the resolution in recruiting Indians for the World War. Third is, consequent upon the breaking of salt law by the Indian people, the Indian National Congress was declared illegal by the colonial rulers. So which of the statements is or are correct? Options are 1 and 2 only, 1 and 3 only, 2 and 3 only, 1, 2 and 3. Okay. As I have been, let's take the option by option. as I have been stressing upon the whole idea that you always need to read about Mahatma Gandhi's autobiography, that is your My Experiment with Truth. And if somebody has read My Experiment with Truth, so this question becomes very, very interesting and very, very easy. Why? Because his role in the abolition of indentured labor were the people who were contracted from India or Indian subcontinent to work in the plantations of New World or West Indies in the present times. So it is itself given in the index of My Experiment with Truth that Mahatma Gandhi played a very, very important role in the abolition of the system of indentured labor. So this question is directly from our classroom teaching, right? And if we take the second option is wrong. Why? Because Lord Chelmsford war conference was happening during the time of World War I, in which he sought the support of India for the Britishers. But the point is, Gandhi actually supported him because he was still being affected by the idea that the Britishers might help him or might give India certain more rights if India is going to support them in the First World War. So Mahatma Gandhi, instead of not giving his support as it is given in the option, actually gave his support to the British in India for the World War. It was only in the Second World War that his idea started to change, and then he never supported the idea of giving support to the British Empire, because till then he has understood that okay, fine, the Britishers are not going to help us in any manner, and it is us only who have to basically create opportunities, and that will not be coming forth, right, if you are going to support the Britishers. So he understood his mistake in the Second World War, but he supported the idea of First World War with the Britishers, right? Okay. The third option says, consequent upon breaking of the salt law. So yes, this is a very, very easy answer, because yes, Congress was actually declared illegal after the breaking of salt law during the time of civil disobedience movement. So the answer for this is option number B, that is your 1 and 3 only. And the second option, instead of not supporting Yeltsin, it was supported by Mahatma Gandhi, right? So this is how exactly you need to understand the whole question, right? The answer is B. Now the next question, with reference to the Indian national movement, consider the following pairs. Person, second table is position held. First is Tej Bahadur Sapru. Position held, column given is President, All India Liberal Federation. Second is K.C. Niyog, is a member of the Constituent Assembly. P.C. Joshi, General Secretary of the Communist Party of India. And the options given are 1 only, 1 and 2 only, 3 only, 1, 2 and 3, right? So what is the correct answer, right? Okay, first of all, when we have studied about P.C. Joshi in the classroom, P.C. Joshi was someone who was very, very influential and instrumental in supporting and rejuvenating the Communist Party of India in 1930s. So he has to be a very, very important member of the Communist Party of India. So this option which is given, we now move on to the answers which are given in this particular pairs. One only, one cannot be the answer because three is also there. So one, option number one gets eliminated. Option number two also gets eliminated because it says 1 and 2 only. Now we are left with two options, 3 only and 1, 2 and 3 only. So this makes our task very, very easy. So what we are going to do next is we need to understand the next two options. So the answer for this is option number D. That is your answer for this is your option number D. That is your idea that all are correct, 1, 2 and 3. How? Let's take this one by one, in the sense that Tej Bahadur Sapru was, as we all know, was a very instrumental person in the establishment of the Indian National Congress. So he was a freedom fighter, lawyer and politician. So, and also he was a leader of the Liberal Party, which was established in the British ruled India. And this was actually a party which was established in 1910. So it was established in 1910 to understand the ideas of British liberalism and basically to have a very, very mature discussions, right? So its major role kind of came forth when the report of the Montague reforms were made public. There was a division in Congress over it. So the moderates actually welcomed the Montague report of 1918, while the extremists said we are not comfortable with this particular report. So this led to a kind of split-like condition again in the Congress ranks. So this led to the foundation of the Congress Liberal Federation in 1919. And this Congress Liberal Federation was actually based upon the ideas of a liberal party which was formed in 1910, as I have told you earlier also, right? So basically the Indian National Liberation Federation was formed in 1919. The party was founded by Surendranath Banerjee, and some of its prominent leaders were Tej Bahadur Sapru, V.S. Srinivas Shastri, etc., etc. So this is how exactly we need to understand the basic point, because these were the most liberal leaders of the Congress party, right? They wanted to actually discuss in a very, very mature way that what exactly will be the consequences of the Montague reforms. Okay. Now considering the second option, K.C. Niyog, member of the Constituent Assembly. So little bit about K.C. Niyog. K.C. Niyog was actually a member and a politician from West Bengal. He was member of the Constituent Assembly of India. He was a member of the first cabinet of independent India and the chairman of the first finance commission of India. So this is how exactly we need to understand things, that K.C. Niyog was first minister in the cabinet of independent India. He was also the chairman of the first finance commission of India. So basically, first option is also correct, and the second option is also correct, and the third, as I already told you, so this is also correct. So the correct answer is 1, 2 and 3. So the next question which comes in front of us is that with reference to Mia Tansen, which of the following statements is not correct? So you have to be very, very careful whenever you are reading this, whether the question is asking which of the following statements are correct or not correct. The point is, if you do not consider this following point very, very seriously, what you are going to do is you are going to lose 2 marks, because the basic trend is to actually follow what is correct, but the question says what is not correct. So you have to be very, very careful whenever you are actually doing a question. Reading the question is half the battle won. Okay. So the question says which of the following statements are not correct about Mia Tansen. So everybody knows that Mia Tansen was a musician at the court of the Mughal Emperor Akbar. Right. Now we proceed forward. So Tansen was a title given to him by Emperor Akbar. Second option says Tansen composed Draupad on Indian or Hindu god and goddesses. Third says Tansen composed songs on his patrons. Fourth option says Tansen invented many ragas. Okay, let's consider statements one by one. So the point is, statement one says if title of Tansen was given to him by Emperor Akbar, and this statement is not correct. Why? Because the title of Tansen was given to him by Raja of Gwalior. By Raja of Gwalior, known as Vikramjeet. Right? So this was title which was not given to him by Emperor Akbar. Okay. So basically, the next option says Tansen composed Draupad on Hindu gods and goddesses. Yes, he composed that. That is correct. Third is, he actually sung songs for his patrons. Yes, many songs were composed for Akbar and others. And fourth says Tansen invented many ragas. Yes, see, even today in India, many schools and many music schools like the Gwalior school and other schools, they actually consider Tansen as their major person. Tansen is someone who is considered to be their god, right? You must be thinking that in the Nitin Singhania's book, what is given is about that Tansen did something for the Hindustani classical music and this and that. But where exactly is this question coming from? And that is why I always stress upon the fact that for art and culture, you have to be very, very thorough with your Hindu newspaper, because in the Hindi newspaper, you tend to find these kind of details. So this is directly from an article which came in Hindu in April 2018 newspaper. So this is how exactly we need to be very, very thorough with the Hindu newspaper. So the source for this particular question is Hindu newspaper of April 2018. So this is how exactly you need to understand things. So option B is correct, option C is correct, option D is also correct. The only option which is not correct is A, and the title was given to him by Gwalior ka Raja Vikramjit, right? So this is how exactly you need to understand things. Next question is relatively very, very easy. Who among the following Mughal emperors shifted emphasis from illustrated manuscripts to album and individual portrait? Humayun, Akbar, Jahangir, Shah Jahan. Okay, first of all, we need to understand that what are illustrated manuscripts. Illustrated manuscripts are something like, supposedly you are having a Mahabharata and there is a scene of Abhimanyu going into the Chakravyuh. So Abhimanyu going into the Chakravyuh will be written on one page, and on the opposite side of that page there will be a kind of picture which will be drawn of that particular event. So we all know that Humayun and Akbar, these two people were more interested in having albums, more interested in having, sorry, not albums, they were more interested in having illustrated translation of the Indian epics, right? It was only from the time of Jahangir, who was himself a very, very important and a very, very famous painter, that the focus shifted to individuals, portrait, right? He started building his portrait centered around in the natural settings, portrait of him hunting scenes, portrait of him having a kind of a relationship with the king of other places, right? So this is how exactly Jahangir was the pioneer in this kind of stuff which happened in the Mughal Empire, that is the shifting of illustrated manuscripts to album and individual portrait, although it reached its zenith during the time of Shah Jahan. So this is how exactly we need to understand things when we are doing this particular question. The correct answer is Jahangir, right? So this is how exactly you need to understand things. Next question says, with reference to Mughal India, what are the differences between Jagirdar and Zamindar? So the option one says, Jagirdar were the holders of land assignments in lieu of judicial and police duties, whereas Zamindars were holders of land revenue rights without obligation to perform any other duty except for the revenue collection. Second is, land assignments to Jagirdars were hereditary and the revenue rights of the Zamindars were not hereditary. Select the correct answer using the code given below. Okay, fine. So the correct answer for the code given below. Okay, the first option says 1 only, 2nd says 2 only, 3 says 1 and 2 only, D says neither 1 or 2. Okay, first of all, the answer is itself in the first statement, first line itself. Jagirdar were the holders of land assignments in lieu of judicial and the police duties. No. So Jagirdars were actually the person who were given these particular land in lieu of their cash salaries, and in lieu of their cash salaries they were also to maintain certain amount of horses and army for the king. And this Jagirdari system became prevalent from the time of Emperor Akbar and also during the time when Mansabdari system was evolved in the Mughal Empire. So Jagirdari system was a part of the Mansabdari system, And jagirs were actually the land assignments which were given to the people in lieu of their cash salary and according to the rent, right? And the statement further says the judicial and police duties. Judicial and police duties were actually being performed by the zamindars, right? So this is how exactly the things will be going, and this thing will also be taken into consideration by Lord Cornwallis in 1793 when he will be implementing the permanent settlement. So when he will be implementing the permanent settlement, what he will be doing is he will be making zamindars the owner of the land, and at the same time he will be giving them certain other functions, that is to maintain law and order, although which will be taken later on by them onto themselves, right? So zamindars were actually the holders of the land revenue, and their claim on the land was actually hereditary. So that is how exactly we need to understand things. Now let's look at the options after considering the first option. One cannot be the option because zamindars, we have already, jagirdars, we have already discussed. Both 1 and 2 cannot be the option because we have already discussed jagirdars were not exactly given the land for the judicial and police duties, but for the services other than this which were performed by them for the king, right? So this is how exactly we need to understand the whole idea. And now let's consider the second statement. The land assignments to jagirdars were hereditary and the revenue rights of zamindars were not hereditary. No, the second statement is also wrong, because although there were certain jagirs like the Watan jagir which were hereditary, but in all the jagirdars were only required to maintain certain amount of horses, collect revenue and give it to the imperial treasury. Other than that, their jagirs were being transferred from one place to another in a space of 3 to 5 years, so that they are not able to maintain their total stronghold over a particular area, so that they do not become very very powerful. So the answer would be land assignments of jagirdars were not hereditary, and the revenue rights of zamindars were not. So here the option would be that it was hereditary. Zamindars were hereditary and the jagirdars were not hereditary at all. So this is how exactly we can see that option 2 also goes out of the window. So the only thing which is left for us in this is neither 1 nor 2. Both the options are not correct at all, right? So I've also explained you why exactly they were not correct. Yeah, next question is, consider the following about the Act of 1813. So the first option says it ended the trade monopoly of East India Company in India except for the trade in tea and trade with China. Second, it says that it asserted the sovereignty of the British Crown over the Indian territories held by the company. And the third option says that the revenue of India were now controlled by the British Parliament. Which of the following statements given above are correct? 1 and 2 only, 2 and 3 only, 1 and 3 only, 1, 2 and 3 only. Yes. So first of all, this is again directly from the classroom teaching which we had done. So most of the questions which have come till now are very very simple, they are very very direct also. So what we need to understand is that I told you people that whenever you are studying the Charter Acts or whenever you are studying the Acts from 1773 until 1935, you have to be very very thorough that what exactly were the differences, what exactly were the major points in each of the acts, and how one act actually differed from the other act. So this is what exactly you need to understand when you are studying any of the Charter Acts, right? So this is what is required. So I will be telling you the correct answer, but before that I will be telling you what exactly was Charter Act of 1813. Act basically ended the company's monopoly over trade in India, but the company retained the trade with China in tea. So company basically the monopoly was lost, but it retained the monopoly to trade tea with India and China. So this first correct option, first is the correct option, right? Now let's go to the second option, which says that it asserted the sovereignty of the British Crown of the Indian Territories held by the company. No, point is, the no, it actually started, right? It basically started a process after which the company's control will be like taken over by the Crown by the Act of 1858, Government of India Act, right? So basically it asserted, yes. And if the question said that the sovereignty was not taken into the hands of the British Crown, the answer would have been no, it was not taken by the Act of 1813, it was taken over by 1858. But it says that it asserted. This is how exactly the word play is happening in this particular question, which says that asserted. So the answer of this is yes, company asserted. So this is also yes. So first two options are correct. So now let's go to the third option. Third option says the revenue of India were now controlled by the British Parliament, and the point is the revenue of India was controlled by the British Parliament since very long, since the Act of 1784, that is your Pitt's India Act. So this Act of 1813 did nothing of this sort. So now we are ready to go. Option says 1, 2 and 3, no, this cannot be the option. 1 and 3 cannot be the option, and 2 and 3 cannot be the option. So the only correct option which is left for us is 1 and 2 only. So you saw that how exactly this question can be done by elimination method. The major source for this was, this question was Spectrum plus your Plassey 2 partition. So these two books will be very very handy whenever you are doing your modern Indian portion. Okay. The next question says, with reference to Swadeshi movement, consider the following statements. This is again directly from the class notes or the video notes which I have already given you in the class. And the source for this particular question is Spectrum History by Rajiv Ahir, and the pages number I am going to tell you, 296 to 297. So the Swadeshi movement itself means that you are now considering the use of indigenous goods and services. So this option 1, that is, it contributed to the revival of indigenous artisan crafts and industries, is a correct option. And I also told you in that particular lecture on the Swadeshi movement, please refer to that lecture, that the national education was also being stressed upon by the people who were participating in a Swadeshi movement. So as we know, both the options are correct. So we can now go to the options, and option C seems the most viable option, in which both 1 and 2 are the correct explanation. So this was a pretty relevant, easy question, and I hope you have already scored 2 marks in this particular question. This is very easy. So the next question is, consider the following pairs, movement / organization, and the leaders who basically formed those or actually developed those organizations or founded those organizations. Okay, fine. The first is All India Untouchability League. Leader it is given is Mahatma Gandhi. Next is All India Kisan Sabha. Leader given is Swami Shraddhanand Saraswati. Third is Self-Respect Movement. The leader given is K.E.V. Ramaswamy Naikar. Okay, which of the following pairs are correct? Options are 1 only, 1 and 2 only, 2 and 3 only, 1, 2 and 3. Yes, so what do you people think would be the correct answer? Yes. The point is, we need to understand the Anti-Untouchability League. Untouchability was a major agenda of Mahatma Gandhi, and if we like have studied Mahatma Gandhi properly, we will come to know, and Spectrum also at the same time, we will come to know that Mahatma Gandhi actually formed this organization, and this particular fact is given in the Spectrum page number 438. This is directly from that particular book. So you need to understand, even if you do not know that okay, Mahatma Gandhi established it, you need to understand something is given of the untouchability. And Mahatma Gandhi was actually champion of the whole movement of untouchability. So he was someone who was responsible for this. And this particular organization was formed in 1932. So this is the extra information which I am providing you with you right now. Okay. Second is All India Kisan Sabha. So All India Kisan Sabha, Swami Sadanand Saraswati. Again, I taught you in the class that it was something which was founded in Lucknow in April 1936. And the person responsible for this was Swami Sadanand Saraswati. And the page number of spectrum is 652. So you see, spectrum is very, very important for your prelims exam, but it is only after you have done all your things from the NCERT books. So the self-respect movement, yes, it was started by E.V. Naikar, and some of you must be getting confused over the name Periyar. So Periyar, who was also known as E.V. Ramaswamy Naikar. So this particular organization was also started by him only. It was something which was done in South India, right? So this is from spectrum. Again, spectrum is again a very important source for this, along with Plassey to partition. So these two books are to be read very, very thoroughly, right? So the correct option is 1, 2, and 3. All the three options are correct. Is again very, very important and very, very easy, which is directly from our classroom teaching. In this particular thing, I have told you people to actually identify all the Harappan sites in the lecture, in the pre and in the post Harappan culture. So I hope you people must have done it very, very perfectly. And this is directly again from the Saviour Academy's coaching videos, in which I will be now telling you that where exactly these sites were located and what was the major idea about these particular sites. Okay, Chand Hudro. So Chand Hudro, I told you people that it is located in Pakistan, which is approximately 130 kilometers of Mohenjo-daro, which is Sindh, right? Again in Pakistan, Kot Digi, again a site which is located in Pakistan. And now the third site which is given is Sohgaura. Sohgaura is something which is located in UP, and Sohgaura is most famous for Ashokan inscription. Ashokan inscription written on copper in Prakrit and Brahmi. So it is one of the oldest copper plate inscription which we found from Sohagura. It is in, and the last is Desalpur. Desalpur is again located along Gujarat. So two sites are Pakistan, one site is Gujarat and one is UP. Now we need to understand Chand Hudro is a very famous site. Kot Digi is again a very famous site which is located in the Harappan culture. Sohgaura only came into existence from the 3rd century BC. So when Sohgaura came into existence from the 3rd century BC, it cannot be something which can be related to the Harappan civilization. Why? Because the Harappan civilization was basically from, like, it was in existence until 1900 BC. So when it was in existence until 1900 BC, that how exactly can Sohgaura can be a Harappan site? That was not a Harappan site. So the correct answer is Sohgaura is not a Harappan site, right? So this is directly given from the book Ancient India, NCERT, R.S. Sharma, chapters Harappan Civilization and the Age of Maurya. Again, I am stressing upon the fact that you need to be very, very thorough with your NCERTs, and you do not need much information outside of your NCERTs. So be very, very careful whenever you are reading for ancient and medieval history, at least only NCERTs, both old and new. Okay, now we come to the next question. Next question says that in the following relief sculpture inscription is Ranyo Ashok that is the king Ashoka, mentioned along with stone portrait of Ashoka. Basically, they want us to tell them that what exactly the inscription has been mentioned along with that of portrait of Ashoka, and where exactly is this particular portrait along with inscription located. So the point is, options are Kangahalli, Sanchi, Sahebsgarhi, and the last option is Soha Gora. So yes, they are very, very confusing option. This was something which was of a like little bit much more difficult question, but the source of this was, but source of this particular book was Upinder Singh. It's a kind of a table which is given in the Upinder Singh's book, History of Ancient and Early Medieval India. And the correct option is Kangahalli. So right, Kangahalli. Kangahalli is a proxy, is a site which is located in Karnataka. It is an important Buddhist excavation site. The most important finding of the excavation include a stone sculptured slab. Stone sculptured slab bearing the name of Rani Ashoka, the first inscribed portrait of Ashoka, which is surrounded by female attendants and queen, is found at Kangahalli. So this is again a very important information. I'll repeat this information again for you people so that you can write. So Kangahalli is about 3 kilometers from Sanathi, Karnataka. It is an important excavation site for Buddhist monuments. The most important finding of the excavation include a stone sculptured slab bearing the name of Rani Ashoka, the first inscribed portrait of Ashoka, surrounded by female attendants and queens, found at Kangahalli. So this is how exactly you need to understand things, right? Okay, now the next question, consider the following statements. First is deification of Buddha, that is treating Buddha as a god. Deification is god. Treating the path of Bodhisattva, that is the importance of Bodhisattva, right? People who are actually responsible for letting others or taking others to the path of salvation, image worship and rituals. Which of the following are the features of Mahayana Buddhism? Options are 1 only, 1 and 2 only, 2 and 3 only, 1, 2 and 3. Yes, for the first thing is, we need to understand what was the difference, and this is directly from the class notes again. And this question can be easily understood if we know the differences between Mahayana and Hinayana. Mahayana and Hinayana are very important parts of, and this is a very, very straightforward question. You people should have got your 2 marks in this particular question. The level was very, very easy. Point is, yes, Buddha was considered as a god because Mahayana believed that Buddha was immortal. Buddha cannot die, right? And the point is, in Mahayana Buddhism, what is happening is that the Buddha, through his bodhisattvas, actually helped people to achieve salvation. So this is also correct. So yes, Buddha was actually seen in images, and various rituals were performed around these images. So all the 3 options are correct in Mahayana Buddhism. So the correct answer is 1, 2, and 3. So this question in Mahayana Buddhism can be easily seen in NCERTs and also in the class notes, right? And also, if you want to read more upon the ancient Indian part, you can actually refer to Upinder Singh's book. And this question was on chapter number 8, that is Interactions and Innovations 200 BCE until 200 CE. Yes. Now we come to the next question, which says that with reference to the forced labor, consider the following points during the Gupta time. With reference to the forced labor, consider the following points. And forced labor during the Gupta time was known as Vishti. Right. So we now need to understand which of the following statements are correct. Yes. First statement is, it was considered as a source of income for the state and a source of tax which was paid by the people. Second statement says, it was totally absent in the Madhya Pradesh and the Kathiawar region of the Gupta Empire. Third option says, the forced labor was to entitled to weekly wages. Fourth says the eldest son of the laborer was considered also as a forced laborer, right? Explanation for this particular point is that Vishti, yes, it was a form of a forced labor which was extracted by either state, provincial governor or local chief. Yes, it is also mentioned on the Gupta era copper inscriptions that says about the variety of taxes, and in those variety of taxes we see that Vishti is also mentioned, right? So Vishti is also mentioned, and the most important inscription which gives us the information about Vishti is the Junagadh inscription. Yes, Junagadh inscription is again a very very important idea, and it says that Junagadh is from Gujarat. Yes, so the second option which says that it was not extracted from Kathiawar region. Kathiawar is in Gujarat, so it actually becomes wrong, because Junagadh inscription says that Gujarat was a place from where this Vishti was actually taken. So this option becomes wrong. Further, we can say that since it was a forced labor in lieu of tax, it was not a wage labor. So how can, like, you are getting tax from it, so how exactly can you say that it was a wage labor? So it was not a wage labor. Wage labor existed in ancient India, but it was not classified as Vishti. Vishti, on the other hand, could be extracted from anyone, not in particular from the eldest son only. So eldest son option is goes wrong. Third option, forced labor, goes wrong, because they were not entitled to wages or anything. So second option says that Gujarat, no, Gujarat was there, because Junagadh inscription says that. And the point is first option which says that it was considered as a source of income for the state is correct. So this is how exactly we can understand things which are given in the examination, right? Okay, and the next last question for this particular topic is that consider the following places. Famous place, rivers. We actually have to match whether the pairs which are given above are correctly matched or not, right? The first place is Pandharpur, and the river along given is Chandrabhaga. Next famous place is Tiruchapalli, and the river given is Kaveri. Third is Hampi, and river given is Malaprabha. Which of the following pairs given above are correctly matched? 1 and 2 only, 2 and 3 only, 1 and 3 only, 1, 2 and 3 only. So the correct answer is 1 and 2 only, that is Pandharpur, there was river Chandrabhaga, Tiruchapalli, there was river Kaveri. And third option which says that Hampi Malaprabha is not exactly a correct answer, right? So now the explanation for this is because we have already seen that Hampi was actually a place which was located in the Vijayanagar kingdom, which is actually the capital of the Vijayanagar kingdom. And if you remember doing this, that Tugandrabhadra was a major river which was a point of contention between the Bahamanis and the Vijayanagars, right? So that exactly solves the problem, that Tugandrabhadra was a major river which was located along the capital of Vijayanagar Empire, right? And for the other parts also, Pandharpur, as we all know, we have already studied during the time of Bhakti Saints, is a well-known pilgrimage town in Maharashtra. Tiruchapalli is again located on the river banks, and it was during the time of early Cholas also, and later on it was developed by the Pallavas also, right? So this is how exactly I intended to discuss the questions, 18 questions which had come in the exam for the UPSC Prelims 2019. I think I have discussed thoroughly each and every option, each and every source for this particular paper, and I rate the portion of history, that is the 18 questions, as relatively easier this year, right? Except for one or two questions here and there, the questions were relatively easier, and you should have easily scored 30 to 32 marks in this particular portion, right? Thank you, and I wish you best of luck for the future endeavors and also for the result of this particular exam. Thank you.